Okay, you're the scientist.
Bring it on. Bring it on.
You've accepted facts, facts and belief. I know the religious people believe, the scientist says prove. What do you believe? What do you think happens when we die?
Well, so I can make some unassailable statements about what happens when you die. So you spend your life eating food. Food has a calorie content, and calorie is a source of energy. Calorie is a unit of energy. You bring it in, and then the energy is available for you to maintain your body temperature at nearly 100 degrees. It's 98.6. How do you keep something at 100 degrees when nothing else around you is? You're burning energy to sustain that, because biologically, we need to be at that temperature to function, okay? You also need energy to walk and to move. That's why you eat food. The moment you die, what happens? You don't maintain the energy. Your temperature drops. How far does it drop? To room temperature. At a funeral in the casket, if you touch the hand of the person in the casket, your first thought is, the body's cold. No, it's not. It's room temperature. But it's cold compared to 100 degrees. They're no longer burning this energy. Okay, so now, every one of your molecules has energy within it. If you get cremated, that energy gets released in the form of heat, and you heat the air, and that air radiates to space. You get buried, which is how I want my body to be disposed of. Bury me. Bury me. Because you know why? I don't want the energy content of my body to just get radiated out into space, of no use to anybody. Put me in the ground. Let the worms, microbes, come in and out of my body. And the energy content of my body that I had assembled over my lifetime, consuming the flora and fauna of this earth.
Doctor, now the question is, what about the time between death and the resurrection of the body? Why is it sometimes called sleep? And we were talking earlier, Tony, as we began this, that this is really fresh for me because yes, at 8 o'clock yeah. this morning, a very good friend of mine went into this state. So where is she? Well, what's happening to her? I mean, this is right now, it is 3 hours and 16 minutes. Picture it. She is 3 hours and 16 minutes into what we're talking about right now. That's awesome. That is awesome to think about. So here's what the Bible says about sleep. This is why he raises the question. Since we believe that Jesus died, this is 1 Thessalonians 4. Since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. All right, that's a reference to Christians who have died. Now, why does he say it that way? Or 1 Corinthians 15:17, if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile, you're still in your sins, then those who have fallen asleep in Christ have perished. So another reference to falling asleep as a picture of dying. And then there's Jesus, where he raised the little girl. We named our daughter after this experience where he says, Talitha kum, and he raises this little girl from the dead, and we know that she's dead because in Mark, I think, 5:35, they say, your daughter has died. And when Jesus arrives to deal with this, he says, why are you making such a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping. Well, she was dead, and he calls it sleeping. Why? My answer is, that this is the way the body looks and acts. It is simply a description of death by a softer picture of what it actually looks like. If you've ever looked at a person who's just died, have they died or are they just sleeping? Because they look like they're just there, like they've always looked, and they're just asleep. So I think it's a picture. It's a pictorial description in a softer way of the actual reality that they've died. Now, Why do I say that? Why do I jump to that idea of meaning instead of just saying, well, no, they are not conscious on the other side of death. They really are in undergoing something like soul sleep. They will have no consciousness until the resurrection. Why don't I say that? And the reason I don't is because Jesus and Paul teach otherwise. So, for example, the two key passages in Paul are Philippians 1:21, to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, yet which I shall choose, I cannot tell. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. So, when Paul contemplates his own dying, he calls it gain, not because he's going to go unconscious and have zero experience for another 1,000 years, but because he goes into the presence of Christ, with Christ, in a deeper, more intimate way, and it is, he says, vastly better than anything he's known here. And then he says the same thing in 2 Corinthians 5:6. We're always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord, for we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please Him. So dying in the body means going to be at home with the Lord. Here's Jesus. He tells this story about the rich man and Lazarus, and he doesn't say that it's a parable. Now, I don't know for sure, frankly, whether it was a parable or not, but he doesn't say it was a parable. He just describes it like it really happened. And if it did happen, or if it is a parable, it seems to be making the point that after death, there's not oblivion or sleep, unconsciousness. There is life in torment or in bliss. So it goes like this. There was a rich man who was clothed in purple and fine linen and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate was laid a poor man, Lazarus, covered with sores, who desired to be fed with what fell from the master's table. Moreover, even the dogs came and licked his sores. The poor man died and was carried by angels to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried, and in Hades, being in torment, he lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham afar off and Lazarus at his side. So the picture Jesus paints, parable or something that really happened, is one of a conscious life in torment or in happiness beyond death. So my conclusion is that Christians have a double encouragement for those who are dying or have died. For the believer who trusts in Jesus Christ, Christ's blood and righteousness have removed the condemnation for every believer and secured for us both final resurrection of the body in a new heaven and a new earth, and now, after death, an intimate, sweet experience of being in Christ's presence between death and resurrection. It is a blessed hope in both ways. We're safe. We're safe in Him now. We'll be safe in His presence at the moment of death, and we will be supremely happy in a new and healthy body forever and ever in the new heavens and the new earth.
What a glorious hope we have in Christ. Thank you, Pastor John, and thank you for sharing these thoughts in the midst of your recent loss. I appreciate it. Well, we're going to end the week by talking about a subject that rarely, if ever, gets addressed, and it's the topic of self-hatred. What hope does the gospel offer those who struggle with self-condemnation and self-hatred in any of its many various manifestations? I've asked our friend and respected Bible counselor David Powlison to join us to explain. and he has agreed to appear with us tomorrow. I'm your host, Tony Ranke, and I'll see you then.